Laura from Equinix here. Let's talk about the OSI model. OSI stands for Open Systems Interconnection, and the model comes from the International Organization for Standardization, or ISO, which you may be familiar with if you've worked with the date time format standard ISO 8601. If you work on any interconnected system, even one that isn't on the internet, you need to allow components of the system to talk with one another. That communication is what the OSI model is attempting to abstract by breaking down how data gets transformed and transported. The OSI model defines 7 layers, and we usually read it from bottom to top. At the very bottom is the physical layer, layer 1, and that includes the coax cables, fiber installations, hubs, and repeaters. At this level, we need to think in ones and zeros. There's no structure to the data involved. If you imagine a server rack in a data center with all the cables sticking out of it, you're thinking of layer 1. This layer is the only layer that actually moves data. We'll come back to that thought in just a little bit. Next up is layer 2. The data link layer. This layer is still partially physical in that it's about data transfer between two systems that are directly connected. Those systems do not have to be connected via a physical hard line though. Your typical wireless access points work at this layer with tables of identifiers called MAC addresses for different devices. At this point, the data is in frames. A small structured sequence that breaks up the data stream into payloads, with headers providing MAC addresses for where those payloads should go. Here lie the switches that link our systems to the routers connected to the outside world. After layer 2, we climb up out of the data center to the network layer, or layer 3. Layer 3 is where we start thinking in packets of data and getting IP addresses. These 3 layers from layer 1 to layer 3 make up the media layers. If you're used to working in data centers, these layers will be very familiar. If you're used to working on top of virtualization engines or focus on containers and up, though, these layers probably aren't something that you recognize. That's okay. It's worth learning them. The next 4 layers are called the host layers, and that's where you probably spend most of your time. So, next, we get to the transport layer, or layer 4. We're finally connecting things. This is where TCP connections appear. Here, we have segments and datagrams, depending on the protocol, which both are packets wrapped up with another header that specifies ports and similar information. Then, layer 5, the session layer. We open sessions or long-running individual connections between systems to allow data transfer here at this layer. Data is just called data here, though it's still being manipulated at a level that isn't human readable. Then we go up to the presentation layer, or layer 6. Think of this layer as the layer where data is prepared, not where it gets presented. Whether you are going up or down the stack, this is where the assembly or disassembly happens. Here, we start to explore security with SSL and encryption protocols, and where we think of file transfer with FTP. Finally, at the very top of the model is the application layer, or layer 7. Application here refers to the protocols that render and serve the data for the user's application, like HTTP or SMTP. Remember, the model is about networking and data, not about user interfaces or user experience. This may seem pretty hard to wrap your head around. It's a lot of jargon. So let's break down the model in a different way. Let's imagine you're sending messages to a friend in a different country. When data goes from where you're entering it in to the eventual destination and back to you, the data crosses these layers. Specifically, it goes from you, the user, down the layers, including the servers you're connecting with, to the physical connection. Then it crosses over to another system and goes back up the layers to be read by your friend. Every time the data crosses a layer boundary, It gets broken down into smaller and smaller pieces. Then, on the other side, it has to get rebuilt from the tiniest pieces back into the larger pieces until it is readable by your friend. Each layer down, therefore, represents not only a smaller piece of data, but also a piece of the network with smaller throughput. If you think of the transport of water from large reservoirs into smaller and smaller diameter pipes until it reaches your home faucet, then you can think about how each connection layer gets progressively smaller and why all of these standards of breaking down data into pieces that can be reassembled reliably matters. Remember that this model is an abstraction that idealizes how systems connect. You may not find it exactly as stated here. A lot of people use this mental model to troubleshoot or run mental diagnostics on networking issues. As I said a moment ago, when you send data from one system to another, you're actually working your way down the layers of the OSI model. So, if data transmitted from one user or application to another doesn't reach its destination, you can mentally peel the layers back to check each layer to find out how far the data got. For example, let's say your data definitely got sent, but there's no record of the data hitting the API socket on the other end. You then know the error is somewhere below the API. So you can check things like whether the TCP handshake is completing between the two systems, or you may check that the packets are going through to the other side via a ping command to the IP address to rule out an error there. And it's not always as simple as going straight down the stack to the physical layer to move data from one system to another in one large push. In reality, the data goes down to the physical connection, but might climb up and down layers as it goes from your computer to a router to a server, across fiber optics, and onward to the next computer. Remember, though, that the data always has to go down to the physical layer to move. But the various data transformations from putting in addresses and ports to encryption happen in different layers. Your traceroute command output may get messy, but the overall model should make sense. While the real life layers have blurred and shifted over time, the OSI model is a great way to explore how data flows from one user system to another and ensure you haven't missed a troubleshooting step along the way. We'll get to explore examples of using the OSI model to troubleshoot production in a future video on the channel. I'll be back soon with another explainer video, right here on Equinix Developers.